This is ThinkTech Hawaii. Community matters here.
Welcome to a healthy and happy 2018 Human Humane Architecture with your every other week's edition with your hosts DeSoto Brown and Martin Despang. So I just got back from Germany. So picture one is me back with my loved ones, personally and professionally thinking about the evolution of tradition. And while I was there, the first show in this year was done by, that's picture number two, by Jay Fidel and by Tonya Moy. And it made me sentimental about the magnificence of the Magnificent Mile here in Honolulu that is about to go. And as modest and moderate Tonya always is, next picture, Jay was a little bit more specific and talked about all the new stuff that's replacing the magnificent stuff from the past being eclectic, but he said that would be too much of a compliment. He then said it's junk. And also some informed citizens look at it that way, as this guy who's quoted here as a response to Kurt Sandburn's blog on Civil Beat. And next picture, not only enough, but next picture, one of our informed Docomomo members took this picture while driving, and because it's referring to a show we did, this is Ward Plaza, and we were hoping it would stay around for a little longer, but unfortunately it doesn't look like it, right?
No, it's got a fence around it, and it's going to be demolished, and that is a disappointment to us.
So that's sad, and so on a little bit more on the bright side, on my way back then, I had an unexpected stopover, next picture, and they put me up in this nice little piece. And it's interesting because they probably didn't want to put me up in the most fancy slash exclusive expensive hotel, right?
No, they did not.
So they put me up in the most budget one.
Right.
And that's one that's classy that unfortunately maybe we don't see that these days anymore. This is a 1969, what was it called?
SeaTac Motor Hotel.
And it used to be, thanks to Mike Guskert who helped us out, it is used to be the largest motel in that region
at its time. That's right. Had 800 rooms.
Exactly. And some of the features that we see here, the big linear detail at the top, reminded us of the project we actually want to talk about today. And next picture, it's still connecting to, I'm still a little homesick because I had to leave my sweetheart Suzanne back home. And we want to talk about the project we briefly touched on in her show, Tropical Tourism, where she was when she was here 20 years ago as an au pair. And tell us where that is and what that is.
We are talking about the Kahala Hilton Hotel and the Kahala Apartments. And so this picture, Suzanne is on the balcony of the Kahala Hilton Hotel, and the apartments are beyond her. And if we go to the next picture, we see a historic view when the hotel first opened in 1964 of what it looked like looking towards Coco Head and Coco Crater from this new wonderful Hilton Hotel.
And you have another picture that you hold on to and give it to people upon special request that shows actually the actual hotel room behind.
Correct.
And there's something interesting because the hotel layout, the plan is pretty generic, an American typical standard double-loaded corridor. But the trick they did is that they turned the hotel room sideways.
Right.
So it's actually facing outside with its long side. And that way it looks way more spacious.
Right.
Because if you look at the facade, it's pretty generic. It's pretty much punched in holes. The opening isn't too big. But the trick is it looks much more big, you know, and spacious as it actually
is. Yeah, there's a secret inside.
It is. Next picture gives us a clue about the authors behind. And this is on the left is the architect Edward Killingsworth, who we see a monograph about his work at the very bottom. And no surprise, the middle picture at the bottom, this project is published in there. And who's the guy on the right who's actually his client?
Yeah, the guy on the right is Conrad Hilton, who was the head of the Hilton Corporation. And at this time, when the hotel was built in Kahala in 1963-64, the Hilton Corporation was very actively expanding internationally, and it was building hotels outside of a lot of the traditional places where they had already been built in downtowns and other places and like that. And the Kahala Hilton is a perfect example of that exact type of motion that they were going through.
So in Hilton, most likely next picture, hired a Killingsworth based upon this project here, because Killingsworth participated in the very famous case study house series from mid-century, which happened on the West Coast in America. And this is the case study house number 25 that he designed. And what they all share is this sort of zeitgeist of these progressive young architects who made architecture that was very simple, almost austere from the outside. But next picture, once you went inside, it totally blew your mind because it was like giving you something spectacular, mostly blurring the inside with the outside. Here, actually bringing the outside into the inside, because there's this courtyard that has some louvers for shading, but it's otherwise open to the elements.
Yeah, and big windows.
And big windows, and it's introducing the element of water into the architecture.
Yes, we're going to see that again, too.
We do that. But before that, step back and tell us a little bit about more about the site, DeSoto, next
picture. Okay, well, in our next picture, here is an aerial view of the site of the Kahala Hilton Hotel, which would be in the lower right corner, sort of in the center part. This is the Wailai Golf Course, which was constructed in 1927 for the guests of the new Royal Hawaiian Hotel. So people would have been taken from the hotel to this golf course. Obviously, it wasn't easy, wouldn't have been easy to build a golf course right next to Waikiki. And in the 60s, this is where the hotel got built. And in the next picture, we've got a view from the new hotel looking out over the site of what became those Kahala Hilton apartments, as well as the parking structure for the hotel. This is what it looked like right when the hotel opened, before these other things had been built, which we're about to show you.
Mm-hmm.
And in our next picture, as I was saying, here's a view, an architectural rendering of the hotel on the left and the apartments on the right. And when the hotel was first built, it was considered to be so far away from Waikiki that people actually wondered if guests were going to want to stay there.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, that is what happened, and a lot of very important people, politicians as well as movie stars and other personalities, liked the fact that the hotel was not right in the middle of Waikiki,
mm-hmm.
as was the Hilton Hawaiian Village Hotel, which we see down in the lower right corner with the pink Jeep in front of it.
Which we're referring to a show that we did some while ago.
That's correct.
Look this up, guys.
Right. And in the next picture, we've got a view of the dining room. This has been altered since it was originally constructed, but they also built that little little island offshore so that you had something to look at that made it an even more romantic, Pacific, mm-hmm. South Seas type location.
So very exotic, as we like
absolutely.
To call it. So it is the next picture,
an
absolutely stunning architectural feature.
Right.
Wow.
And that walkway over the lagoon where the porpoises are jumping for many years was like that, just this thin, very elegant looking concrete strip with no railings. And nowadays it's this very hunkered down, very significant structure with railings. In those days they had it totally different.
And where did these good times go?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And this is also the on the far side of the lagoon has also been developed since this picture was taken,
mm-hmm.
as well.
And the next picture shows us, subtitled this as being fuzzy, because, and we can already jump to the next picture, because the big architectural challenge was, how do you basically make this big chunk of a program and building basically blend in and not looking austere.
Right. And monolithic.
Exactly. And we jump to the next picture. It gives a little bit of a detail where you can see it's sort of trellised, it's sort of camouflaged with this additional layer. And in the front, you also see some very sort of industrial, generic, these are these famous double T's that we see at the end of the show, some of us like these days again. So these are, it's a very sort of international style, rational building that yet sort of had some reference to some sort of vernacular tectonics, which we see on the next picture, which is actually a preview of the projects we're actually going to talk about. But he did the same in the hotel and in here. You can see this very bony sort of language of architecture.
Like
skeletal.
Exactly. It's like a freestanding skeleton around these structures.
Absolutely. But before we go there, let's stay in the hotel and go to the lobby. Right, quick next picture.
Yeah. So this is the original lobby of the hotel in 1964 and a very recent view of the lobby. And you'll see that while the furnishings have changed, they've kept the same basic structure as well as those specifically commissioned light fixtures, which have what look like beach glass pieces,
mm-hmm.
hanging from them that are kind of an icon of the hotel. So they've never messed with those, mm-hmm. even while they've made other changes.
And another part, sort of a lobby as well, as the next picture is a sort of open area where the water pours under the building, and I guess where the dolphins are, right?
Right, right. And this is still like that today. It gives mm-hmm. this very much more lighter appearance rather than monolithic, heavy, mm-hmm. solid mm-hmm. appearance. Mm-hmm.
And if we go up in the building, next picture, we can pretty much see this sort of, you know, signature language of Killingsworth, that on the left is that case study house. You can see how he brings the outdoors inside. And the same is in the multi-storiness of the hotel, where through extending out these beams and sort of, you know, bracketing these members, you almost have the feeling he's creating another sort of outdoor space, yeah. like a lanai.
Yeah.
And while, you know, this project also, I forgot to put in a slide, but there's, if you Google, you find a lot of celebrities
yes.
throughout the years
oh, yes.
staying
yes.
in the hotel.
Right.
I hope you guys go to Diana Ross, which I do this Friday, mm-hmm. and it wouldn't surprise me if he would stay there.
That's right. I mean, no, that's true. And that's one of the things I said. When President Johnson came here in the 1960s for peace talks mm-hmm. involving South mm-hmm. Vietnam, he stayed at that hotel
yeah.
because he could be taken there by helicopter.
Mm-hmm.
They could land on the golf course,
mm-hmm.
and he could be guarded more easily.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And next picture, we actually now go next door
right.
and talking celebrities. This is certainly not, both projects are not basically a low budget
no.
or inclusive. They're rather exclusive.
They are.
Up to these days, you can see the cars there speak for themselves. But there was also a famous guy in history related to Hawaii who actually
yeah.
permanently lived there in our project.
That's
who,
right.
Who
That's
was
right.
that?
Okay, well, that was Jack Lord. And let's come back to the studio so we can show people what we're talking about. And there he is. That is mm-hmm. the German version of Hawaii 5.0 with Jack Lord on the cover.
Mm-hmm.
And Jack Lord lived at the Kahala Hilton or the Kahala Apartments. Because it was exclusive, because it was attractive, it was convenient for him to get to work at the Diamond Head studio where
mm-hmm.
he worked.
Mm-hmm.
And again, upper class, expensive, exclusive,
mm-hmm.
and very trendy at the time
mm-hmm.
it was made.
And I have to thank my best friend Stefan, who gave me this set. This is actually the second season,
yeah.
and these have the entire, you know,
yeah.
CD set in
yeah.
there. And again, as you were surprised, you never heard this in another language.
No.
This
oh.
is the Y 5.0, and it is also tells you how popular that still is.
Absolutely.
So this is legacy and tradition
That's
of the
right.
islands, and so is the building. So next picture, please. Because the building is actually a non-building. This is how you approach, and it looks like a jungle. This looks
right.
tropical. This looks lush. And next picture, the architecture in there also looks like, you know, trunks.
Yeah.
But they have this nice feature of a negative corner. In
yes.
architecture, we call this the mesian corner. So they went through some effort to actually make the structure more skinny, more delicate,
and as I just
more
said,
elegant.
It's less monolithic, it's less heavy, it's less weighty, because it's got that empty corner. And it goes exactly along with what we're saying.
Absolutely. And the next picture, also the beams. The beams don't just stop where they could stop,
yeah.
according to their primary function
Correct.
Of structure. They actually project out.
Yes.
And this is an interesting sort of play that's typical for these mid-century Hawley architects who came
yes.
and were looking at indigenous structures, because
yes.
when you were doing the Hawleys, you had to do that
yeah.
because you had to latch them. And
right.
so you had to project out with your member to get your stuff
right.
around, right?
Right, right.
So this is an interesting, but it's not a basically a literal, which everything we see today is a palm leaf imprint
yeah.
or a chevron or something. This is truly modern, but it's sort of an exotic modernism.
Yeah, and it's an abstraction of exactly what you were talking about of a traditional building style. And it does serve a structural function, but it also decorates the structure in a very attractive exterior way
mm-hmm.
that looks, I wanted to say, both of these buildings to me look really elegant.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the thinness and the airiness and the delicacy is what gives them that elegant appearance.
Absolutely. And next picture, here comes that water feature
yeah.
again. Here is the building in part sits in water, and that's rather challenging to keep that, you know, the water from not stinking
yep.
and also keeps from the building not getting wet. So this is pretty high end, pretty luxurious, and it's just beautiful. I mean, this is as tropical as you can get it. Also, only in these you know, climatically privileged tropics, yes. Evaporative cooling works yes. a little bit. So this yes. also helps to climatically cool Correct. The building. So it's not just decorative.
And as you said, too, this is a very mid-century technique.
Exactly.
That, and occurred in other places.
And another feature, you know, what else do we associate with the tropics? And when we swim here, tropical fish, next
yeah.
picture.
There we are.
Here they are.
There we are.
It's all incorporated. So it really has an exotic theme, we can say. Next picture. But again, the architecture is almost hidden. I mean, these are actually, so the floor plan of this building is like a comb or like a hand with the fingers, and the fingers are actually the dwelling units. Mm-hmm. And so there are these linear courtyards. They're heavily vegetated with these tropical vegetation.
Correct.
As we can see. And next picture, every now and then, sort of the architecture glimpses through.
Yes.
So it's mostly not existing, but every now and then it just pokes through, as you can say, with these sticking out members, and you get this sort of dialogue between the natural branches and the artificial
And
branches.
Also, because this is an expensive building, they are able to do that level of landscaping, which you mm-hmm. do not find in most buildings because mm-hmm. it's so labor-intensive and it's expensive.
Yeah, also in maintenance, right?
That's what I mean. Yeah, it's expensive to Absolutely. Maintain all of that.
Absolutely. And the next picture is showing something when you actually see the architecture. And there's something unfortunate happening because the story in the middle is actually the original one where it was all open and the lanai, and you see the ceiling fan. It was easy breezy. And I heard that some contractor came in some many years ago, or, you know, manufacturer of these aluminum window systems, and basically sold it to the clients with the result of putting AC in, making it more hermetic. And you said it was all about the maximization of square footage, raising the value, because all of a sudden then that became living space, so your unit became bigger.
That's
so it was
exactly
all about the money.
That's right.
All about capitalism.
Right.
And initially, it was a cultural approach to saying we're in Hawaii, we're in the tropics, we want to love the outdoors, right? And another, which unfortunately, the original thing which was unfortunate is the next picture, which is the circulation, which is the hallway.
Yeah.
And you were quoting your mother and having known people who basically lived there and even, you know, criticizing that way back.
Absolutely. That she thought the building was very nice. And when it was a new building in the 60s, of course, everybody wanted to go see it because it got a lot of publicity. And I remember she's always maintained that it's a beautiful building and the units are nice, except the hallways look terrible.
Yeah, and who am I to criticize my famous colleague Killingsworth? But I would say, and I'm sure maybe he probably would have done it, just, you know, keep the beams running across and making a catwalk that's separated from the walls, as he actually did in a project we see very soon, and then having some linear skylights to bring the light down, maybe even making the courtyard outdoors, which he has done in other projects. But as you said, this was probably not on a tight budget, but was made to make profit.
Yes,
so that probably the dirty term of value engineering happened here.
I think it did.
But next picture, at some other details, you can still see the original. This is a really nice, delicate, filigree jalousie, wooden jalousie with this original hardware that's still there and speaks of the sophistication
of
the architecture,
installed.
Both architecturally and climatically.
Yes.
And another nice feature is next picture, which is also part of our permanent background, where there's these planters. So architecture, you know, at the ground floor, so plants are incorporated into the design, and this planter trough, and then it's also, you know, staying true to that theme of sticking out, projecting out.
And I think that the thing that strikes me is that's concrete, but it doesn't look massive.
No.
It still maintains some level of delicacy or lightness in spite of the material.
And good point, because actually of the end, because it almost seems that this end cap is pushed back in.
Yes.
So you see the trough in section is actually a U, like the letter U, and he just inserted it. And that's a sort of level of sophistication
Absolutely.
That especially mid-century architects seem to have more than, unfortunately, these days.
Correct.
And this picture, I took this at the end of the unit facing the ocean, which we can see in the next picture. where this is the conclusion of the project, and all of a sudden, you know, you get out of the jungle, and all of a sudden, you're at the ocean. Yeah. What a surprise! What a spectacle!
Yeah, and I can also point out that Jack Lord and his wife Marie lived in one of the optimum units in the building, which they were able to get,
of course,
which was at the end, right next to the Kahala Hilton, so they didn't have as many neighbors, and they looked out right on the ocean and the beach.
Mm-hmm.
So they chose the nicest one.
Absolutely, and probably no surprise to our viewers, we often have a mission. The mission of this show here is, we go to the next picture, to prevent this project to happen to it, what happened to this nice project here, which is also a Killingsworth project on another island. Which one, DeSoto?
This is on the island of Maui at Kapalua. It was the Kapalua Bay Hotel. And as you've pointed out, when the, well, essentially it's been demolished.
And bummer.
Yeah, it is. And it, again, is something that you wouldn't be able to replicate today. And it wouldn't be replicated
and
today.
And you see, I mean, you know, he was working here with four columns,
yeah,
you know, as opposed to one, and was really indulging in this theme of bracketing, of layering structure.
And we got the projecting horizontal members as well.
You got the water pouring in, you got nice shading, and you know, what a shame, and especially what a shame, because next picture, we don't want to look at that too long. But I'm just quoting basically Jay, who says, you know, modern architecture is mostly junk.
Yeah.
And, you know,
this is what replaced it.
This is what replaced it. And this is a generic developer thing and none of the passion and dedication to an interpretation of local sort of exotic inspiration we see here.
And I think also, too, it's fair to point out that the level, even a concrete building, even a plain concrete building, or not plain, but a concrete building can have a lot of elegance and can have a lot of detailing, which sets it apart from everything else. And that's what we saw with the Kahala Hilton and the Kahala apartments.
I like that, the way you put this. And before we actually, I want to go a little deeper into that, but next picture, I want to not forget to thank the one that I owe, you know, that I was able to take the pictures, all the pictures I took, because Nathan Toothman and his family had the chance to live there for a while until they were not able to afford it anymore. But this is his Elevate, which a couple of shows ago we featured it. And you can say with the sort of the filigreeness and the elegance of these members, you know, I think to a certain degree, probably it was an inspiration. And, Nathan and Tiffany told me it was. So thank you guys for that. And the next picture is my testimony of me and my family business being very sympathetic to what you just so nicely said, that these are all bare to the bones buildings.
Yeah.
These are bare tectonics. And even in their completion phase, they basically stay like that. And there's nothing wrong in celebrating the raw and rugged of construction and achieving, you know, elegance and delicacy. We don't need the sort of makeup that we see on buildings these days.
Right. You know? And we also don't need bunkers.
No,
we don't need concrete bunkers. And that is kind of the easy, cheap and dirty way to do it. And to get beyond that may be more expensive than what people consider to be affordable or possible.
Exactly. And so this here being said, next picture, a great local master of the same thinking, of the same ideology, if you want so, was the structural engineer behind the project. This was Dr. Alfred Yee, and these are pictures from his website because he was the structural engineer of record for the building. And here you can see it going up, and he very proudly, you know, talks about the efficiency and effectiveness of the construction. So it's very sort of cutting edge at its time. Very modern, very prefabricated. And then again, but you see, you know, it's when you see how close the units are, if it wouldn't be for the vegetation that is so important, people would have never liked this. It was like, oh my God, I can see my neighbor. Oh my God, it's so close. I don't like
that's
that.
Right. That's right.
So, you know, a little bit sort of respectfully disagreeing with you when you said, well, today, you know, vegetation, people are afraid because of the maintenance. But if you look at a jungle, an actual jungle is no maintenance,
right?
So the question is, which kind of plants do you plant? Mm-hmm. You always use this nice term of decorative or ornamental. If you use plants who are not native to here, you got the trouble. But if you choose the right plants, that maybe need a little less. So why don't we incorporate more
landscaping
vegetation?
We haven't talked about landscaping very much, but that is absolutely crucial. Mm-hmm. And it is a matter of maintenance. What will grow, what won't grow? Mm-hmm. You simply cannot put a plant in the ground and say, I like that, therefore I want it there. Mm-hmm. It will not necessarily live. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's just like building a building. You can say, I want the building to look like this. You may situate it in a place that it won't work.
Absolutely. So the next picture shows Alfred Yee, and actually this is top right is a picture I took in his office when I had the chance to meet him before he unfortunately passed away about a year ago. And so these are all the pictures of the projects, and these are all the projects we basically have covered or will cover, because these are the most innovative. You see Ala Moana Hotel. You see the Frank Fazi building that I think we should do a show about.
We did a little mention of it.
We have Alfred Price's Arizona Memorial, and then, you know, sort of hard to see because they're reflecting, but there's tons more out there. And there, here is the Kahala Hilton Hotel and the condominiums. And at the bottom right is Dr. Yee and myself and me with a lot of, I was very nervous and went there because I was asking for his advice about a project that we have shared with the audience a couple of times, and we will now do with the last picture soon, which is Primitiva. And I basically asked him about, you know, structural issues. Yeah. And I was so touched because I got the biggest compliment from him that we could have gotten, because he said, Martin, it actually reminds me of Queen Emma Gardens, which is another project he has done, which we also should do a show about.
Yes.
And he said, just like Queen Emma Gardens, it's a building that lives, that is alive. Yeah. And he said, I don't want to talk about structure. We can figure this out. This is not rocket science. But I want to talk about the humane, the name of the show, aspect of the building and the approach.
Right.
So here's Primitiva, and you can see an homage to Killingsworth and an homage basically to Alfred Yee as the team, and a plaidoyer to why don't we do the raw and rugged again, the necessary, why don't we live easy breezy, why don't we incorporate nature and people and all of that into architecture. So with that, we're at the end of the show.
Yeah.
We see you guys in 2 weeks. And a project that's somehow related, because now we're on to wanting to save the few good vintage stuff we have on the island.
That's true.
We spotted another one that we think we should address. Which one is that?
We're going to talk about La'au Gardens. La'au Gardens and the La'au project, or the La'au area, is 2-3-story walk-up buildings built in the early 1960s. The La'au Gardens is one of them.
Yeah.
We've had discussions about the different buildings that are located in this place, what we like, what we don't like, etc. And they probably are threatened. We know redevelopment is very likely for that area, and so we need to, at the very least, document it, talk about it, and at least advocate for some of it to be retained, if possible.
Very good. And speaking of advocating, next show is going to be with Chief Socrates from the Honolulu Fire Department, who is a great supporter of some of the ideas we had.
True.
So we look forward to that. See you then. And until then, stay as exotic as you can. Bye-bye.